laboratory. So Chiao Lai is a PhD student who developed the MATLAB program to compute elastic field of discrete dislocations using the Stroh-Form invariant in presence of multiple interface. But actually, his PhD student is about slip transmissions and dislocation pileups at gun boundary, and also is doing some experiments on micropillar compression, B-crystalline micropillar compression, and is co-advised by Stéphane Barbini and myself. So the talk of today is about misorientation dependence of gun boundary migration rate. Okay, so I will start with some quotation from literature from our review paper, which says that in FCC metals, so from gross selection experiments, they have overwhelming data, and generally they show that the fastest moving boundary are observed for a 111 axis and rotation about a 40 degree misorientation angle. Okay, so here there's an experimental paper, so but there is numerous, so I'll just pick one, where you have the mean boundary migration rate with respect to misorientation degree, sorry, and you have a peak, a rather broad peak, around 40 degrees, and here we have the deviation from the 111 axis, okay? So in mesoscopic models, so that we have seen a lot during this week, so the velocity of gun boundary is the product of mobility and driving force, and generally the misorientation dependence comes from the capillarity term, so in the gun boundary energy. And today I will talk about the misorientation dependence that we can have in the stored energy term. So generally the stored energy term is computed at the dislocation line energy times the difference of dislocation density between both grains. So if you look at a polycrystal and if you consider an isotropic elasticity, you have actually different elastic moduli inside each grain due to their different orientations. And because of this, since we have to, if you consider that grain boundary are perfect interface, so you have to satisfy continuity of displacement and traction vector. And so because of this, you have image force to satisfy these boundary conditions. This means if you consider, for instance, a dislocation in an homogeneous medium, and if you add an interface, you will have additional force, and this force can have attractive or repelling effect on them. And more importantly, is that because of this, actually, the stored energy, it is when you compute the elastic energy due to a dislocation, depends on the distance between dislocations and grain boundary. So this is the talk, the main subject of this presentation. So to begin with, a brief recap about image force. So you have two elastic moduli, so two grains, C1 and C2, one dislocation here, model like an edge, which is from edge to the interface. So GB is for grain boundary. Okay, so you can compute the image force as the pitch collapse force at the dislocation position. So if you are in an homogeneous medium, we consider generally that the dislocation is in stiff equilibrium, so you have no force on it. But if you consider so the stress field due to dislocation minus the stress field due to the homogeneous medium, okay, and you apply the pitch collapse force, so B is the Burgers vector and T is the dislocation line direction, okay, you get an image force. So we can have, which can make the dislocation move. And another way to compute an image force is to see it as a negative of the gradient of the interaction energy between dislocation and current boundary. And here you have a formula which is maybe clearer. So you can compute the image force as here you have the pre-Gronig factor of the energy when the dislocation is in homogeneous medium, so in medium one here. And here, when the dislocation is exactly at the interface between medium 1 and 2, or at the interface at the grain boundary, okay? So if you see that that this term is smaller than this one, so it will be thermodynamically favorable for dislocation to go there, and so you will have an attractive force. And so image force is always, so what I did not say is that to consider this formula, you have to consider a 2D representation, where the dislocation line is perpendicular to the grain boundary, and the grain boundary here is just, it's a simple discontinuity between two different orientations, okay? And so in this case, the image force is always perpendicular to the grain boundary, capital N is the normal to the grain boundary, okay? Something which is useful also is the image force theorem, which says that actually the image force is the same for all, so always in this 2D representation for all the grain boundary planes which are parallel to the dislocation line, okay? So here, you have no dependence about the plane of inclination of the grain boundary within this setting. Okay, and so here, so the idea was that you can see that if you have the intuition thanks to this formula that if you make the grain boundary advance towards these dislocations, you will have a decrease of stored energy, of elastic energy, if you have an attractive force, and an increase if you have a repulsive force. Okay, so this is the first objective of this presentation, is to check the following hypothesis that we will consider, for instance, some dislocation array, for instance, after recovery, so it can be a sub-grain boundary, a low-angle boundary, okay, and we will make the grain boundary advance towards this dislocation array, so an array with identical dislocations, and we'll see in case we have attractive image force, if we have indeed a decrease of elastic energy or an increase in case of repulsive image force, and then what we want is to quantify numerically the change of elastic energy to see if it is significant and if it should be taken into account. And then we will investigate if we can get some misorientation dependence about this image force in FCC materials and maybe a possible correlation with experimental observation. So first of all, I will begin. So this is the only slide with equations about Stroh formalisms for 2D elasticity. So U is the displacement. So in general, for linear elasticity in 2D, you can write quite generally the displacement as some constant vector A, a function of Z where X1 and X2 is the position where you want to compute your field, your displacement, and P is also some constant to be determined. You use Hooke's law and balance of stress, and you get what is called a sextic equation because you have 6 root of P to solve, and C is your elastic moduli, your anisotropic elastic moduli. So this date back from the 50s. And so the solution, of course, the displacement are real, are given by this. So you take the real part of this, where A is a 3x3 matrix containing the eigenvectors. And actually, in P, we consider only the roots with positive imaginary parts. So what now we have to determine the function F. So in presence of an interface like this, you have F can be written like F0, which is the solution in homogeneous medium, plus a term where you compute your field in grain 1, and a second term when you compute your field in grain 2. So F is given by the boundary conditions, okay, and depends on the dislocation position, which is here capital X1 and capital X2. And in homogeneous mediums, the boundary condition is that when you make the integral of the displacement on a circuit enclosing the dislocation, you should retrieve the Burgers vector. So here you have the relation with the Burgers vector, and all the other matrix are related to the elastic moduli. And then F1 and F2 are solved by applying the boundary conditions about continuity of displacement and traction vector. And so V1 and W here depend only on the elastic moduli of both crystals. Okay, so this is for the theory. Now we will make a small simulation. So we consider some grain-free dislocations, some planar boundary. Again, it is just a plane of discontinuity between two orientations. And here we consider some array of 20 dislocations in initial equilibrium. So we apply a very small homogeneous stress that comes from the other grains, defect in the other grains, just to equilibrate the image force. And okay, and here we can make also a perfect dislocation walls, like a low angle boundary if you wanted. Okay, so this is very general. And then we will just displace, so this is a theoretical experience, the grain boundary towards this dislocation array and see what happens. Okay, and through this evolution, we will compute the elastic energy through this formula. So this is simply the classical formula for elastic energy. So it will be an elastic energy per unit length of dislocation. So all the dislocations here are parallel to the grain boundary because we are in 2D. So I did this for two materials, aluminum, because most of the experiments are about aluminum, and it has a low elastic anisotropy ratio, and copper, which has a much higher one. So to make comparisons. Also a word, to compute the elastic energy within our setting in linear elasticity, we have some singular solution at the dislocation position. So this is the dotted black lines. So we made a regularization by extending the dislocation core along the slip line. Okay, so in red, so to perform this, we have to make an integral. So, and so there is some numerics. So this is the order of the Legendre polynomial to make this integration. So you see that in red we have the exact solution. So you still have a singularity, but it becomes logarithmic, so it is integrable. But with n is equal to 2, you already have a smooth field through the dislocation curve, so it is already satisfactory to make the calculations. And here, for instance, you have the boundary which is here, and so you see that this component sigma 1,1 is discontinuous, but all the solutions reproduce well this stretch jump. So we consider edge dislocations on a specific slip system. So as I told you, your active slip system are spaced by 25B. So the misorientation is less than 2 degrees. So here, actually, we do not consider it. We say that the orientation is homogeneous in this grain. And we consider two orientations for crystal 2, one which is around 111 and another around 110. And actually, we'll see that in one case, we have attractive force and the other repulsive force. So this is the homogeneous internal stress to have achieved initial equilibrium. So aluminum, it is much lower than in copper. And it depends if you have attractive or repulsive image force. And then we make an integration over a rectangular surface area around our dislocation array. So first of all, here we check that you have numerical convergence. It means that we are very far from your dislocation array. The variation of elastic energy density becomes negligible. Okay, so here is plot the variation of elastic energy divided by the dislocation line energy that you can find in mesoscopic model. And here is the migration distance of the grain boundary. So when you increase your surface area, your solutions are closer and closer, so you have some kind of convergence. And also when you increase your Lorentz polynomial to perform the integration of the elastic energy, you have a convergence too. So the general trend here is pretty reliable. Okay. So now the results about image force. So for orientation A, you have attractive image force. So here, attractive image force, you have positive resolved shear stress on the dislocation. So this is for the 20 dislocation. And whereas for orientation B, you have repulsive image force, so negative resolved shear stress. And what is important is that you have a 1 over R variations. So it is already known that actually image force can have a strong influence. It is much higher than lattice frictional stress close to the interface. And about the variation of elastic energy, so you see here in dotted line is copper, in full line it is aluminum, and in red it is for attractive orientation, and in blue for repulsive orientation. So for attractive orientation, you have a decrease of elastic energy, and in B, an increase. So our assumption is correct, and also the amount of this variation is about 1 dislocation line energy for aluminum and 6 for copper, which I found quite significant. Okay, so now a conjecture. So we have seen that, so here we have 2 specific cases, but now we have to have more general results. So the question is, which grains are the more prone to show such a decrease of stored energy? So it is actually a little bit time consuming to compute each time the elastic energy density. So here we will just compute the image force on 1 dislocation to have some qualitative results. So at a given distance from grain boundary, since we have seen that we have a relation between image force and variation of elastic energy density. So we consider a single edge dislocation, always parallel to GB, at a given distance, 5B along its slip direction. And we'll consider different orientation for crystal 1 by considering the 12 slip system of FCC. Okay. Once you set your slip system and put a dislocation on it, actually your orientation is set because we want that the grain boundary is normal to X2. And by doing this, we obtain, we take crystal 2, we deduce crystal 2 by rotation around 111. And so we get this result. So here you have the image resolved shear stress on your dislocations. So you see that for the 12C system, you have 3 slip systems where you have positive image force and with a maximum around 38 degrees. So this is quite intriguing regarding the experimental observation. For some, you have no image force, some repulsive, but with a magnitude which is less than for attractive force. An intermediate case. Again, the question is, how significant are these values compared to the whole set of orientation? So to do this, we consider random orientation for crystal 2. So I use a method of Moravec to generate random Euler's angles, okay, and keep within the set only the one which have Hamiltonian rotation higher than 1 degree with all the other set of Euler angles, times the 12 rotation capital one, we get more than 300,000 different Hamiltonian rotations, and we get this result. So this is the same plot, image resorptive stress with Hamiltonian rotation angles. Okay, so our first remark so is that you have not, so here we can assume that we have sweep the whole cubic space, okay, for orientation. So we have, so this is not symmetric because we consider specific dislocation on specific slip system. Also, here you have a plateau that is reached after 30 degrees. And then I have highlighted some specific rotation axis, so 110, 001 in green, and 111 in red, with misorientation of plus or minus 3 degrees. So you see that here you have something which is larger than in blue. It's because here we have three systems, where here it corresponds to only one slip system. And so we can say that the 111 are among the ones which have the highest resorptive stress, but it is not the case. So for our same kind of grand boundary described with this misorientation and angle and axis, you can have different values, because actually it depends on the orientation of your dislocations, on which slip system it is. Okay, the same for copper, so it is not exactly the same figure, but you retrieve the same thing, a plateau after 30 degrees, and and also you can check here the value which are much higher in copper. And here we highlighted only the 111 plus or minus 10 degrees, because this is what is reported sometimes in the paper. So you see that you cover a large range of the highest image resorptive stress, okay? So this is for aluminum, this is for copper. So some discussions. So here we have seen that grand boundary with misorientation between 30 and 50 degrees, about axis within plus or minus 10 degrees around 111 are among those that can displace the highest attractive force. So by all what I told you, we can assume that the decrease of stored energy for those grand boundary towards some dislocation array can display a strong decrease of elastic energy among the strongest possible. So it is tempting to say that there might be a link with the observation in gross selection experiments. So here I remind you that we describe grand boundary just as discontinuity of orientation, but just by doing this, so we have non-negligible elastic interaction between dislocations and grand boundary in anisotropic elasticity. So as recovery is controlled by interaction between dislocations, so maybe in recrystallization, elastic interaction between dislocation and grand boundary have some importance, or at least, so of course, the other driving force should be predominant, like capillarity or the decrease of dislocation density, but this can have a slowing down or an accelerating effect on grand boundary migrations. And also what is interesting is that you have a direct dependence on crystallographic parameters, okay? So I finished with this. So the real picture is eventually more complicated because it is 3D. Here, I did not consider the extrinsic elastic field of grand boundary that can be modeled with dislocation or disconnections, okay? Elastic field of dislocation core, so we have also image force on dislocation core interaction with GB that should be important when we are close to the grand boundary. So this can be taken into account in the transformations by considering dislocation and force dipoles, so curvature. So polycrystals also, so if we have to, so the question is, we have to consider the misorientation between the two grains or with the mean orientation of the crystal. So my intuition is that you should consider the misorientation between neighboring grains when you are close to the grand boundary and misorientation with the mean orientation of the polycrystal where you are far, okay, interaction with impurity. Here we did not make move dislocation, but of course, if image force are above the critical force, they will move. And so with attractive force, we can assume that they will be closer to grand boundary, so this should be have an influence, okay? And this is the conclusion that you can read, so this is actually what I say before.